to the Lord.
Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come before him with thanksgiving.
And extol him with music and song.
Exalts a nation, but sin is a disgrace to any people.
Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, we know that first and foremost, when we believe in you, we are citizens of heaven. And we are grateful for that, Lord. But you have placed us today here as citizens of a country. And we are very grateful to you for the freedom that we have, the freedom to worship and the freedom to live and to have so many choices and opportunities. We thank you for that freedom. We thank you for the security that we have and all those who have a part in providing that to us. And Father, we also thank you for the security that we have in you, because we know that you are going to meet all of our needs and that we can trust you completely. And we thank you today for that, Lord. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Simply trusting every day, trusting through a stormy way, even when my faith is small, trusting.
Trusting us, oh God.
Sunday morning, our sermon series, Songs for the Journey, inspired by the wonderful book, A Long Obedience in the Same Direction by Eugene Peterson. These songs for the journey are taken from the Psalms. And today, we read Psalm 125. Those who trust in God are like Zion Mountain. Nothing can move it. A rock solid mountain. You can always depend on mountains that encircle Jerusalem. And God encircles his people. Always has, always will. The fist of the wicked will never violate what is due the righteous, provoking wrongful violence. Be good to your people, God, to those whose hearts are right. God will round up the backsliders, corral them with the incorrigibles, peace over Israel. As I said, these songs for the journey are taken from the Psalms, including this Psalm of 125. And these psalms have to do with the songs of ascent. The people of God, three times a year, going from wherever they lived to the city of Jerusalem for special days of feast and celebration. And on these journeys, often they would sing. That's what the psalms are. They are songs. And so today, we look at this particular song that the people of God were singing on this particular day on their way to Jerusalem. My guess is that all of us these days are very concerned about our own safety and security. The last time I remember feeling this way at all, feeling similar thoughts and concerns that I have been feeling these last few weeks and months since we have been in this pandemic, was a time back in 2001. You remember it, I'm sure. September 11, 2001. I was on my way to take my car to be serviced. My mobile phone rang and it was a friend who said, "Have you heard that a plane has crashed into the tallest buildings in New York City, the World Trade Center?" I had not. I was shocked. At first, across the country, people were thinking, surely this was an accident. likely a private plane. But then it became clear that it was not a private plane. In fact, it was an airliner filled with innocent people. Well, you know the rest of the horrible story. A few days after 9/11, a member of my church, First Baptist Church in Lawton, where I spent the last 15 years of my ministry before retirement, called me. This particular man was the head of the Communications and Public Relations Office at Fort Sill. As many of you know, Fort Sill is the largest artillery training center in the world. I have here one of my most grateful memories from those years. It's a coffee mug, and it was presented to me by, it says, the United States Army, Fort Sill, Oklahoma. And it has an emblem on it that says life and health. And it is a treasure to me, along with some other wonderful memorabilia that I was given because it was my privilege to be the pastor of First Baptist Church in Lawton and to have some of the most outstanding people from all over the country who were there as military officers and enlisted men and women, some of the brightest, finest, most talented, committed young adults that I have ever been around in my entire life. And so on this day, when I received a call from one of my deacons, one of my friends who was, as I said, a head of the Communications and Public Relations, Public Affairs Office at Fort Sill. And he said to me, "Pastor, I have just come out of a meeting. We have been discussing security measures here at Fort Sill. And after we talked about all the things that we needed to do here on and around the installation, we started talking about what other targets that if there were terrorists who were going to carry out other attacks in our country, what would they possibly choose?" And the term soft targets came up in our conversation. By soft targets, we mean those targets that you might not think of, those targets that don't typically have much protection. And we began to brainstorm about what some of the soft targets might be in the Lawton-Fort Sill area. And one of those that we talked about were the churches. And we particularly talked about First Baptist Church. Now, the reason they did is because First Baptist Church was one of the largest, if not the largest, churches in the city of Lawton. And our morning worship services were televised in all over southwest Oklahoma and many parts of North Texas. And so our church was very well known. And my friend said to me, "For these reasons, I think we may need to think about what we could do at the church to tighten our own security." And I said to him, "John, you ask some people to meet with me, and we will talk about what we might do." He immediately agreed to help me with that concern. And so we did. We met, and we began to talk about how we might tighten our security. One of the things we realized was that on the east side of our worship center was parking that people could park on the street. And we became concerned about who might park in those spots. And so we assigned some men every Sunday morning to be sure that the people who parked in those particular spots were members of our church. We also, on the front side of our church, which would have been the south side, had some glass doors and a whole row of windows beyond those glass doors. And we were quite concerned about the fact that there was a drive-through right in front of those glass doors and windows. So we began parking vans that the church owned in that drive-through to be sure that no one could drive up and then actually drive through those glass doors with explosives. Another interesting thing that happened was that a young FBI agent, I think maybe he was on his first assignment there in Lawton, Fort Sill, called me and said to me, "Pastor, I want to talk to you about something." He said, "I don't always wear my firearm, my weapon, but," he said, "in these days, in this situation," he said, "I would like to have your knowledge and your blessing of my carrying my weapon." It happened that he sang in the choir, and he said, "Of course, my weapon will be under my choir robe." I immediately said, "Do it." Now, that's was kind of out of the ordinary for me. I'm not particularly fond of the idea of people carrying weapons, concealed or unconcealed, even to today. But at that particular moment, at that particular time, in that particular situation, it was very comforting to me to know that this young FBI agent who sat every Sunday, not more than 15 or 20 feet from where I was preaching, had his firearm that at least would provide some little protection if something terrible happened. During those days, we did everything we could to protect ourselves, to provide for our own security at the First Baptist Church in Lawton, Fort Sill. We're living in a time in which we're all, during this pandemic, doing, hopefully, everything we can to provide for our security. This particular psalm, Psalm 125, is about a human need, a human concern to live this life as secure as we possibly can. These people, on their way to Jerusalem, were thinking about their own personal security on the journey. And as they sang words that indicated that they believe that, first of all, their security was the road they were on itself. Their security was the mountain on which the road led them. They believed that the mountain was secure because it had been there for hundreds or thousands of years. And they could see how strong, how sturdy the very mountain was, and thus how the mountain road was secure in itself. And so they, first of all, sang about their security in the journey on the road itself. I'm sure most of us who have grown up in this part of the country have likely been to Colorado. And there, and near the city of Colorado Springs, we all probably remember there is a mountain called Pikes Peak. Now, Pikes Peak is not the highest mountain in Colorado, but it comes pretty close. And the amazing thing is, there is a road all the way to the top of the mountain. It encircles the mountain and goes all the way up to the top. And the interesting thing about making that drive is that you really don't worry much about the stability of the road, because the road is as secure as the mountain. Our security, first of all, in this life is our journey. The journey of the people during the day that the psalm is talking about was their journey from home to Jerusalem, their journey toward the temple of God, there to meet and celebrate and worship God. There is something about our journey, just being on the journey, that provides security, safety, stability, hopefulness, encouragement along the way. Our life of faith, according to Psalm 125, is as secure as the mountain, as the road itself. But they also sang about how they understood that their security not only was in the journey, but the security was in their destination. In the song, they sang about the mountains that encircled Jerusalem. As cities go of that particular time, Jerusalem was a secure city. It was securely sitting in what Eugene Peterson calls a saucer of hills. And these hills provided Jerusalem a great deal of protection. The person of faith, we as people of faith, are secure in the journey, but we're also secure in our destination. Jerusalem was representative of the very presence of God. Psalm 46, first two verses, also from Peterson's The Message, reads like this: God is a safe place to hide, ready to help when we need Him. We stand fearless at the cliff edge of doom, courageous in sea storm and earthquake, before the rush and the roar of the ocean, the tremors that shift the mountain. Now, as we have been saying all along, it is important for us to understand that the Psalms, and particularly these Psalms, are poetry rather than prose. They celebrate God. They remind us of God's work and God's providence in our lives. But they do not attempt to explain all of that. Not only do they not attempt to explain it, they're honest, quite honest about the questions that go with this kind of thinking, this kind of faith, this kind of believing. Note that last line. The mountains are secure, but they do sometimes quake or experience tremors. The writer of the Psalms would certainly understand questions that all of us likely ask at one time or another, and probably all of us are asking during this time. Why don't I feel secure? Well, let's be honest about it. Most of us know, and most of us have experienced, the truths that we have just laid out. There is security in the journey. There is security in the destination. But still, there are times when we don't feel secure. Why is that true? Well, first of all, it's true when we fail to trust Yahweh, when we fail to trust God. Our sense of security is directly related to our willingness to trust God. The Apostle Paul, in his writing to the church at Philippi, said his peace was not dependent upon circumstances, but was dependent upon Christ. This psalm reminds us that there is no security in backsliding, according to the words of Peterson. Now, backsliding, or being a backslider, is a part of the old language of the church. People years ago used to talk a lot about people who were backsliders. I remember reading the history of the little church that my grandmother and grandfather were charter members of, and I read about all kinds of things that happened, and in one of their business meetings, they had withdrawn membership. They had withdrawn fellowship from one man because he had gone fishing on Sunday afternoon. Now, that was a different day, but it was a day in which people in the church often took this idea of backsliding very seriously and sometimes took it way too far, as I would think most of us would think they did in this particular instance. But backsliding in this psalm uses the term not in our doing something wrong in terms of our doing something immoral or illegal, but backsliding here has to do with our failure to trust God. We stumble and fall sometimes on the road up the mountain when we refuse to trust God. Someone has suggested that Israel, or the people of God in that day, lived a sawtooth history. One day they were up, the next day they were down. Peterson, in his book, describes it like this. One day, they were marching in triumph through the Red Sea, singing songs of victory. The next day, they were grumbling in the desert because they missed having Egyptian steak and potatoes for supper. One day, they were marching around Jericho, blowing trumpets and raising hearty hymns. And the next day, they were plunged into an orgy at some Canaanite fertility shrine. One day, they are with Jesus in the upper room, listening in rapt attention to his commands and receiving his love. The next day, they are stomping around and cursing in the courtyard, denying they ever knew him. Now, I want to be very quick to point out that occasional backsliding does not make you a backslider. All of us at times have stumbled. All of us at times likely have slidden backwards on our journey. But you cannot stumble yourselves out of the presence of God. You may begin to backslide because of your failure to trust God for a moment, but you only become a backslider by the willful choice to abandon God. God will not abandon you. We're reminded of Judas in his betraying Jesus as worse as anyone possibly could. We're reminded from 1 Timothy, two people by the name of Hymenaeus and Alexander, who evidently also fell away from their faith, their loyalty, that they abandoned God. God did not abandon them. Now, Psalm 125 says that backsliders are in the same corral with the incorrigibles. And the incorrigibles are those who refuse to begin the journey in the first place. Now, as we begin to conclude the thoughts about this psalm, I want to say to you that God does not abandon you. You cannot do anything that will cause God to abandon you. The only thing that will separate you from God is your abandoning God. You're determining that you are not going to love, to trust, to follow the God who made you and the God who has come to be with you through Jesus Christ. I also want to remind you of a lesson that we learned in that time in Lawton, Fort Sill, right after 9/11. We did everything we could do to protect ourselves. We did everything we could do to be secure. But the bottom line was, we knew that as much as we had been able to accomplish, as much good thinking as we had done, planning that we had done to try to take care of ourselves, we knew there was no 100% guarantee. There is no 100% guarantee for us on our journey. You cannot pray enough to guarantee your security. You cannot pray a magic prayer. You cannot pray a prayer that God loves and wants to hear enough to guarantee your security. The truth is, there are no guarantees in this life. We simply trust. We go on the journey. We go on the road up the mountain and trust the stability of the mountain. But in the final analysis, we trust the security of our destination, because we know that ultimately our destination is into the very presence of God. Someone said, the last thing that happens to you in this life will not be the worst thing that happens to you. If you are a person of faith, if you trust in God, when your eyes close for the last time, when they close permanently, and your life is over, life in the presence of God begins for you. There is security in our destination. Heavenly Father, remind us of that in these uncertain days. These days when we cannot be sure that we will go through any day without getting sick, without being exposed to this plague. But remind us that you are with us, There is security in our journey. But above all, there is security in our destination to be with you forever. We know this is all because of you coming to be with us through your Son, Jesus the Christ. And it is in His name we pray. Amen.
We hope you've enjoyed our worship this morning. As you go about this week and you celebrate Independence Day, our hope for you is that you are able to be thankful to the Lord that we live in a country where we get to worship like this freely. So have a wonderful week and a happy